Ventilation, the name is fascinating, no? Because it gives you a sense of relaxation, of calm. What are you doing? Protecting. Great. It seems as a mother. No? But we protect the lung from what? From ourselves, not from RDS. And the name protective lung ventilation, what really refer to? Refer to the low tidal volume, and everybody agree, or to low tidal volume plus the open lung approach. This was the original proposal of Amato, because at first we used protective lung ventilator, I think was an editorial of Marini, JJ, years ago, and the first in the title was Amato, but was speaking about the lung protective strategy, because the focus was on the open lung. And the tidal volume, lower tidal volume, was a consequence. Then came out the NIH trial, and say protective lung ventilation becomes basically the low tidal volume. Because if we consider the protective lung ventilation, the ensemble of the two, well, the low tidal volume compared to the higher, there is a lot of experimental and clinical evidence that is true. In terms of opening the lung and keeping the lung open, I think is more that we continue to say the same thing to the congresses than a real, evident reality. Anyway, let me give you my actual idea about that, because more I become old, and I'm already old, but more and more doubts I have on many things that will appear quite clear maybe years ago. Now I have many doubts. Let's see. First, the respiratory support. Why we don't cure RDS. We try to keep alive patients with inflammatory edema of different degrees, because this is the RDS, nothing else. And greater is the edema, more difficult is the ventilation, because smaller become the lung open to the ventilation. But I prefer to look at a thing in two, to split the problem in two. One is what we do with the knobs of the ventilator. And the other one is related to the lung condition. If we speak about proposition, homogeneity, PEEP, we are referring to something here. But when you speak about the tidal volume, flow, respiratory rate, again PEEP, you are referring to something which is related to this. Of course, the interaction between the two may creates the problem. So the protective lung ventilation, in my view, you can use the word as you like, is the most wise combination for what we know now between the handling of the ventilator and to handling the lungs, taking the lungs in the best condition to make our mechanical ventilation less dangerous as possible. And of course, for simplicity, nobody speaks about the transpulmonary pressure. But the real problem is what's happened to the lung, not to the respiratory system. And the lung are inside the chest wall. And the chest wall may play some role. As an example, here are patients with a transpulmonary pressure of 28 at 30 airway plateau. 30 plateau is accepted safe threshold limits. This patient, 28. Now, if you take an animals at 28 of transpulmonary pressure, you kill the lung in 24 hours. At the same plateau pressure, this patient has 8 centimeters of water. And I don't have any other way to understand if I am here or here than measuring. But it still is not in the use. Now, when we apply, I would say, some energy to the system, energy is movement. When I apply some energy to the system, I distend, the force is applied to the skeleton of the lung. And the skeleton of the lung is made by the fibers system, which have the elastin, which is an elastic system, and we have inside, which is folded here, the collagen. Then is progressively unfolded until it reaches the total lung capacity, because it cannot be extended. These are the anatomical limits of our mechanical ventilation, because anything we do is between FRC, which is reduced, and the total lung capacity. And the relationship between two volumes is about 1 for FRC, 2.53 per total lung capacity. Even during RDS, if I 300 milliliters of the baby lung, my total lung capacity is about 900 milliliters. If I have in a normal man 1 liter, it's 3 liters, 2 liters and a half, 3 liters. If it's 2 liters, becomes 4 liters itself, 5, and so on. And these entities are linked, the pressure that I put in the system and how the system react are linked by one proportionality constant, which is called specific elastance. That means, if I take, well, let's say I have an FRC or 1 liter, I take a syringe or a balloon, I inflate the lung with 1 liter, and I'm measuring to the esophageal pressure, the transpulmonary pressure, the value that I obtain is the specific elastance, which in the man happens to be around 12 centimeters of water. So what is the specific elastance? And try to really get this concept. Is the transpulmonary pressure at which the initial volume double. If I have FRC 1 liter and I put 1 liter, the volume is twice. The compliance is 12. What is interesting, that is in RDS, not in COPD, in RDS, the specific compliance is pretty normal. That means that I know that when I have 12 of transpulmonary pressure, I have double my baby lung. Whatever is the starting point, if I have 24, I have 3 times. I am at the top of the total lung capacity. And I know when I start to touch the total capacity area is a disaster for the lung. Because I have try to imagine to take a deep breath, try to take twice. Try to imagine to do a 25 per minute or 20 per minute for 1 hour, for 24 hours, for 2-3 days. The lung is destroyed. And everybody of you read literature. Well, no, I think you read the abstract. No, I think you read the conclusion of the abstract of some paper. But if you read the literature, it's not unusual to find we take the rats and we apply the lung protective strategy. And you see, great. And what is the lung protective strategy in the rat? 6 milliliters per kilo. Which is absolutely wrong. because the ratio between the body size and the lung size is different in the rat, and is different in the man, is different in the dogs, is different in the pigs. The specific elastance, that means the pressure which is necessary, transpulmonary pressure, to double the lung, is 12 in men, is 6 in a pig, is 4 in the rats. That means if I have 30 of plateau in a pig, is equivalent more or less to have 60 of plateau in the man. And if you compare different animal species, you have this tremendous difference which have never been taken into account. But extremely few papers who try to deal with this comparative physiology. But what we know in a series of experiments, that if I take a normal animal, and a normal animal, I think, is the normal lung is not different, really, the baby lung, from the characteristic of a normal animal starting with, because I ventilate the open lung with the same specific compliance. If I use a strain of 1, means I double the FRC, that means my transpulmonary pressure in men should be 12, in pigs will be around 6-7. After 2 days of mechanical ventilation, nothing happened. He has to take a normal man and to ventilate with a tidal volume of 2 liters for 15 times per minute. The equivalent animals, nothing happened. However, if, starting from 0 PEEP, if I give 2, grade around 2, so I start to enter the total lung capacity, so in a pig with 300, my tidal volume is 600 milliliters, I have a disaster. For a few hours, nothing happened. After 6-7 hours, I start to have edema. In 2 days, the animal is dead or moribund with a big edema. And you see that if I take the strain here, so how much is the tidal volume compared to the starting volume and the stress? Here in pigs, at around 2, I start in the risky regions. And you can see here, at the strain 1, the transpulmonary pressure is 6, which is the specific elastance. And analogous in men, this point would be at 12 centimeter watt. However, if I take the same lethal strain, let's see, 2.5, I'm sure that I kill the animals. And I say, no, wait a second. I don't give 2.5 as a tidal volume. I arrive at 2.5 of strain, but starting from some PEEP. And let's see, I give 25%, 50%, 75% as a PEEP volume. And so I move only this part. And these experiments were planned to have 100% of PEEP volume plus the extracorporeal remover. But it was not necessary to do so, because in this condition, in 2 days, the lungs were perfect. Which is a little bit different from the Dreyfus paper, which reached. They were using the rats, and the rats explode independently on the people when they reach some level. But in this, which were 2 days of mechanical ventilation, it was clearly that was the tidal volume. The PEEP, and you say, well, of course, we know the PEEP is protective. Well, my dear friends, is the PEEP protective of the directly, or PEEP protect as much as it obliged to reduce the tidal volume? Because if I use the same tidal volume here, this one, yellow, the animal will last 35 seconds. Poof! Will explode. Right? So this makes a thinking. What is really the, everybody said tunnel volume, no, the flow, the what is the fashion now, the driving pressure. But are these are components, I think, or exactly of on only one reality. If you take volume, pressure, respiratory rate, flow, if you take everything together, what is called is the mechanical power. Is the energy that I put in the system in a given amount of time. As with the metal, if I start to apply energy to a metal, I may have some metal fatigue. And it's not the only the strain or only the tidal volume. As an example, when we look at the rate, we found that the little strain of 2.5, it was done 3 times per minute, the lungs were okay. Frequency. If I have a hammer and I won't break my foot, and I want 1 per minute, it's different than if I put 30 or 1. The same with the ventilator. So, if we take here, the transpulmonary pressure times the volume is the product is energy, which is equivalent to the force. The force area divided by the volume is force per movement. Tidal energy times the frequency is the power. You have to add also the resistances, and we have to consider where the PEEP goes in this picture. PEEP is pressure. So the lung is very happy to be at this standard. Well, sometimes yes, sometimes not. And this standard, how much? You have tried to quantify whatever thing we do. And when we put energy, we know that about 80% of the energy is dissipated in the system. If I have very high tidal volume, even more. Dissipated, what means? That I cannot recover. And when I put energy in this table, I start to challenge the molecules that compose this table. Now imagine I have the fibers of the lung, the fibers, and I have full of proteoglycans, hyaluronan, the system between elastin and collagen. When I start to break, if I put energy enough to break the molecular bonds, my polymers become smaller. When they become smaller, they may activate the inflammation. But the problem is that the fracture is just a molecular bond which break because I put too much energy in the system. And now look very simple here. Let's see, I start to inflate and I arrive up to this volume. I start to inflate, the pressure rise. Okay? This is very simplistic because it's quasi-static. But the area of energy I put in the system is this triangle, right? Now let's see that I have a PEEP. I start to inflate the lung from this. But the energy is not delta pressure times delta volume. It's the change of volume times the absolute values of pressure. If I start with 10, to go to 11, so to put 1 milliliter, I don't have to just add 1 PEEP. I have to overcome this pressure. I have to put the energy enough to overcome the tension I have already in my system. But, in this condition, the area of this is lower than the area of this. If I have a very high peep, I start from this condition, but the area of energy is extremely low. So, you know the motion equation. Everybody knows. It seems complicated, and it is a little bit, but not much. Because the times, if I take the last tense, times the delta volume, the change in volume, this is the pressure that distends the lung, okay? Plus, if I take the product of resistances and flow, this is the pressure which moves the gases. If I don't have any flow, but I have a PEEP, I have a pressure in the system, which is equal to PEEP. Now, the energy is the product of pressure times volume, okay? Now, if I take the change in volume and I multiply each of these members, I get the mechanical power equation, which is respiratory rate. This is to convert centimeter water in joule. And you see that, as an example, the tidal volume goes to the square. I have this apparently complicated equation, but tell me, how much is the contribution to the mechanical power that I put in the lung of the different components? And when we looked, compare this equation, the energy computed with this equation, compared to the energy computed, drawing all the volume pressure curve and so on, we found some impressive relationship in pigs and some impressive relationship in men. That means we have a very analytical instrument which can be used with a computer in 20 seconds to know how much energy I'm putting in the system in that particular moment. And these are the components. If I double the tidal volume, the mechanical power is multiplied by 4. If I double the PEEP, the mechanical power is multiplied by 2, keeping all the rest constant. The frequency goes up on an exponent of 1.6. This gives you the relative weight. That means, as an example, I decrease the half the tidal volume and I double the frequency. Okay? The total ventilation is exactly the same. In terms of mechanical power, it's lower, because the frequency goes to an exponent of 1.6. And I decrease something which is at the exponent of 2. And we just published that in TestCat. There is a link, you can have a calculator on a computer, it's for free. You just, okay, you put what you have and see. And it's too early to say if there is some magic number, because of course this energy must be normalized for something. Because the energy I put in an elephant is nothing. If I put the same energy in a rat, the rat poof, explodes, right? So I have to divide energy by the simplest way is the FRC, so the gas volume, which is reasonable way, it's not perfect, but it's reasonable. And the number I have in mind is something around 50 joule per minute per milliliters, 50 millijoule. In this question of energy may become little. This is the part of the ventilator. Then I have the other part. How much I have? 6 minutes? Okay. So let me put a stone in the water. The atelectrauma. Atelectrauma comes from three sources to me. An editorial of Lachman, open the lung and keep it open. Who revisited the theory of mead, which is beautiful. Second, from the Slasky, Valenza, and Tremblay experiments on isolated rat lungs, looking at the cytokine, and more or less from the Ranieri paper, which was okay, say, decreasing the tidal volume, but less cytokine. But if you go and try to read what really a telectrauma is, it's not so easy to understand. Because according to some author, the telectrauma is something that happens in the terminal way with the telectasis closed, which remain closed. When they open, the epithelium is okay. According to others, is an extension of the maldistribution of stress strain. But it's really so important because everybody knows, okay, I can prevent pedal trauma. I take a syringe, I do a recruitment maneuver, I open up the lung. Great. Then I increase the PEEP to keep the lung open. Okay, how much? How much PEEP, how much lung? As an example, this I have tremendous difficulty in get this paper published, maybe it will never be. Are 34 patients, of which 18 patients in severe RDS, in which we study all the inspiratory recruitment and the expiratory recruitment of 5 and 15. To make a short, a long story, I start it here. I inflate with a tidal volume of 6-7 per milliliters per kilo, starting from 5. Or I can start from 15 and I inflate with 6-7 milliliters per kilo. This is the amount of tissue recruited. And you see, here recruited, then when I go back, this is de-recruited, this amount. So this is the tissue which open and closing. At 15 of PEEP, is a little bit less, but not significantly different than 5 of PEEP. To have 0 open up, open and closing, I should have probably a PEEP greater than 25. Look at the frequency oscillation. Is the perfect lung, open lung, low tidal volume strategy, right? Because I keep the lung at 30 and the tidal volume is very little. But the delta pressure is 6-7 for maybe 400, 500, 600 times per minute. The mechanical power that I put in the system is tremendous. And this tension, the mechanical power due to 30 of PEEP is very high. And so it's not surprising for me of the failure. So the real clinical problem we have, my dear friends, is to use very, very high pressures to keep all the lung open, to preserve this atelectrauma is okay, or the price I pay is too high in terms of mechanical power and so on. I don't go on this homogeneity, which is another problem, but it's the same line. When I put the mechanical power, the distribution of mechanical power in a non-homogeneous lung will be inhomogeneous as the stress strain. And for the lung, I have only two things to do. First is to make the lung more homogeneous, proposition in severe, that's it, is a must in severe RDS. The PEEP may decrease this homogeneity, but not too much. I think PEEP is okay to maintain some gas exchange, but to use the big PEEP following what I'm afraid is a bit the myth of keep the lung open and put 20-30 pressure, I have many doubts that is true. So I think that we are trying to organize a big study in which I want to test this hypothesis, the real open strategy, but in an adaptive trial, so not to kill patients. But, and this is my last slide, to me, lung-protective strategy is less energy in more homogeneous lung. And this is just one, I think we have a sort of goat in Frankfurt in January, and the logo is Dubito Ergo Sum. I would like that all these authors speak no more than 15 minutes each, and to have a lot of time to review what we did for 30 years and look at the reality possibly with the eyes of a baby. Thank you for the attention.